Welcome back. So continuing our discussion on the chemical kinetics chapter, what we have seen so far is that rate constant, the dependence on the rate constant of the concentrations of the reactants and the product. But majorly what we are missing on one point here is the rate constant depends on the temperature of the system. Temperature of the system or temperature of the reaction, whatever. Okay, now what we will study now is basically effect of temperature on rate constant of a reaction. Okay, now it is very much means I would say obvious that a temperature is very much is influences a chemical reaction. It's very much possible, obvious. But what is the relation then? How it affects? Okay. Experimentally, for any reaction, experimentally it has been found that if you plot for an experimental any ln of Kr, rate constant, where Kr is your rate constant. Okay, for any reaction, if you plot this ln Kr with respect to 1 by T, what you will get? You will get a slope, a straight line with an intercept here. And let's say this intercept has ln A. I'm assuming take this one as the ln value of the rate constant and this ln A, and it will have a straight line. If we have a straight line and the straight line has a slope. And this slope is basically EA, that is the EA divided by R, where your EA is called the activation energy of the reaction. Okay. Now if I together use this graphical represent graph and convert this to the equation, I will get ln Kr is equal to ln A minus Ea by R. Or if I just little bit do that, Kr is A into exponential minus Ea by RT. Now this equation is called the famous Arrhenius equation. This is called the famous Arrhenius equation. And literally it shows that how the rate constant is dependent on the temperature. Okay. Now this Ea by R, this can be function of temperature or it cannot be a function of temperature. You cannot say this one because you're assuming here it is constant, but it can be sometimes the function of temperature and can be sometimes not a function of temperature. Now, for the cases, let's say for a reaction, if I talk about, for any reaction, you have a reactants to product. Now, if I plot the energy diagram, energy with respect to a reaction coordinate, if I plot the energy of the reaction, what I will get? This will be the reactant energy of the reactant. So this is my ER. ER is your energy of the reactant. Let it write here. ER is the energy of the reactant. Okay. EP, let's say the product I am assuming here. Product is stable product. This is EP. EP is the energy of the product. Okay, EP is the energy of the product. And this one is, let's say, one transition state, one transition state. So the energy of the reactant is undergoing a transition state, and that is and forming the product. Now this is the energy barrier of the reaction, that is E. Capital E is the energy barrier of the reaction. Energy barrier. What is the energy barrier? The energy barrier is the minimum energy required to convert the reactant to the product. That is called the energy barrier. Minimum amount of energy required. Okay. Now, this is the energy of the reactant scale, and this is the energy of the product scale, and this is the total energy of the reaction scale. Now, what this reaction has to do? This reaction has to travel this path first. The reactant has to travel this path, then what it can do, then it can go here. The reactants from here, it will go here, and then it will convert to the product energy value here. So it has to go from this part, this energy, to this energy. Now this energy is called the red one. This energy is called EA. That is the EA is nothing but the activation energy of the reaction. Activation energy. And this activation energy with respect to the reactant. Again, if I talk about the product, because this can be a reversible reaction, right? So if I talk about the product also, then the product has to cover this part. The product has to cover this amount of energy to get back to the reactant. So we can say this is EA prime, that is the activation energy with respect to product. So activation energy with respect to product and the activation energy with respect to reactant, both are different, definitely. But in general, what we consider for a reaction is basically the activation energy with respect to the reactants. Okay, now about this one, the free energy, as I already wrote, okay. Delta H, that is the enthalpy of the reaction, if I talk about, that is basically the energy of the product and minus energy of the reactant. Now, if your delta H is lesser than zero, that means the reactant, the energy of the product is lesser than the energy of the reactant, then this reaction will be called exothermic reaction. In the exothermic reaction, that means the total energy of the reactant is higher compared to the product. That means if we use the law of conservation of energy, then for an exothermic reaction, the energy of the product plus there will be some heat. So this total energy will be equal to the reactant because the energy of the product is lesser than compared to the reactants. Okay, that means the heat is released during the reactions. Now, if your delta H is greater than zero, then it is called endothermic reaction. Endothermic reaction, that is what? That means in case of endothermic reaction, your energy of the product is higher compared to the reactant. That means the product is basically absorbing the heat energy from the surroundings. Okay, and it is getting the highly energetic compared to the reactant. So in this case, the reaction will be an endothermic reaction. Now if your delta H is equal to zero, then this will be called isoenthalpic process. Isoenthalpic process. Now energy of the product, now this variation you can see from here. Okay, now here, what is this reaction that I'm talking about? The energy of the product is lower compared to the energy of the reactant. That is, this is definitely an exothermic reaction. Okay, so this is what the dependence of the temperature and the concept of the activation energy, of the reaction. Now, let's derive this relation. theoretically, if I deny, let's say, okay, so let's drop this one. If I deny, let's derive this relation theoretically, how it will look like, let's see. Okay, now there is an equation in chemical kinetics, it's called Gibbs-Helmholtz equation relation. Now according to the Gibbs-Helmholtz equation, at constant pressure what we know, ddt of delta g by t, delta g 0 by t, standard, this is standard state, the delta 0 dg 0 by t will be equal to minus delta h 0 by t square. This is the relation. Okay, now what we know, that for a reaction delta g is equal to minus rt minus okay, so let's put this here. So what we can write, we can write d of ln k by dt. Okay, d of ln k by dt is equal to 1 by k d dt of delta g, because we know delta g is equal to minus rt ln k. Okay, delta g is equal to minus rt ln k. Okay, now this k is what? This k is your equilibrium constant. This k is basically the equilibrium constant, right? Equilibrium constant. And what is this k? K is basically the ratio of the rate of forward reaction divided by rate of the backward reaction. Correct? So let's put it here. So what we will get? So what is this? This is nothing but your delta H0 by T square minus delta H0 by T square. Now what is this? What is delta H0? This is basically the free energy. So the energy of the product minus energy of the reactant. And if I reverse this, the energy of the reactant minus energy of the product. Okay. So D of K1 by K minus 1 divided by dt will be equal to energy of the reactant minus energy of the product divided by t square. Now if I integrate both sides, what we will get? We will get k1 by k minus 1 is equal to minus er minus ep divided by t, if you integrate. Okay, there will be dt here. If you integrate both sides, you will get this one. Now in general, what we can, okay, acha, now this one, so okay, there is a ln here, so ln this one, so this k1 or ln k1 minus ln k minus 1 will be equal to minus er by t, so minus of minus common ep by t. Okay, ep by t, something is wrong. Okay, there is a r here. Okay, that's fine, huh? This was our spacing. Okay, now because this r will come from here when I'm not putting this dln k, so there will be an r here. Okay. So ln k1 will take this term and ln k2 will take this term. This is term for the product and this is term for the reactant. So in general, what we can write from here? We can write ln k rate constant, which is equal to minus of E A, activation energy E A divided by R T. Okay, D ln K, ln K. So the difference between ln k of anyone, if I compare this with this, and we can compare this with this. Okay, now we can also do in this way, that d of ln k is equal to, we can say that minus common, if I take er minus ep divided by rt square. So what is this energy? Nothing but this energy is basically the energy required to get from the reactant to the product. Okay, so this is what is called the activation energy. So we can write ln k is equal to d ln k is equal to minus e a by r t square. And if I integrate this again, I will get ln k is equal to minus E by R T. Indeed, I will get, okay, plus constant. अरे यार तुत R T square. And if I integrate this, ln k is equal to ln a, that is one integrating constant, minus E by R T plus ln a. So if I do this calculation here, so I will get k is equal to a into e to the power minus ea by rt. Okay, so hence the Arrhenius equation. So this derivation is not important for your exam that much, but you can get an idea that how we are calculating this, using calculating this effect of temperature on the activation energy, means on the rate constant of the reaction. Okay, now what happens that if we use a catalyst in this reaction? Catalyst. Okay, so effect of catalyst, if you talk about the effect of catalyst. What a catalyst does? A catalyst basically increases the rate of the reaction. Okay. Now, does it changes the rate constant? Definitely. Otherwise, how it will? So, catalyst takes part in the reaction, but remains unchanged. Remains unchanged during the reaction. Okay, so if I plot that graph, that reactant with respect to product, reactant and product, this energy graph, let's say this is an uncatalyzed reaction and this is my energy barrier of the reaction. This is the energy barrier. Okay, energy barrier. Okay, now sorry. Okay, this is the activation energy EA. This is for uncatalyzed reaction, energy barrier EA. Now if I use a catalyst, what it does? It basically decreases the activation energy. This is the reactant of product. It decreases the activation energy. So now what is the new activation energy? This way. This is EA, new activation energy, and it is for a catalyzed reaction. So what a catalysis reaction does? Now for a catalysis, it basically decreases the activation energy. Now the catalyst with decreases the EA, okay, that increases the rate of the reaction. increases the rate of the reaction. Why? Your rate constant is constant into e to the power minus Ea by RT. Now if your Ea decreases, then minus Ea by RT will increase. So this part will increase, so your rate will increase. Correct? Okay. So your, this is called positive catalyst. Now if there is a catalyst which actually increases Ea, then it decreases the K, rate of the reaction. So then this will called, so what will happen for a negative catalyst? So it basically Ea negative catalysis. So negative catalysis increases the activation energy. So it will called a negative catalyst. Okay, so this is all for your effect of catalyst of a in a chemical reaction. So what it does, a positive catalysis decreases the activation energy of the reaction, and a negative catalyst increases the activation energy of the reaction. Okay, so this is all from your effect of temperature and on the chemical reaction kinetics and the Arrhenius equation and the effect of catalysis. Okay, thank you.